Hello everyone. Today I'll start with chapter number 2, that is sexual reproduction in flowering plants. Coming to the first session, what is meant by flower? So what is meant by flower? Flower, it is a reproductive part of the plant body. It is very attractive and it is a reproductive part of the plant body, and flower has a small stalk. That stalk is said to be, what do you call, pedicel. And then the tip of the pedicel is like this, and this is said to be thalamus. And on the thalamus there is a presence of other floral parts. So flower, it is a reproductive part of the plant body. It has a stalk that is said to be pedicel, and the tip of the pedicel is said to be thalamus, and on the thalamus there is a presence of other floral parts. Culturing of flowers are said to be floriculture. Culturing of flowers are said to be floriculture. And then flower consists of 4 whorls. First is calyx, second one corolla, third one andrecium, last one gynecium, also known as pistil. There are 4 whorls: calyx, corolla, andrecium and gynecium. Now calyx, it is the first whorl of a flower, consists of green colored structures, are said to be sepals. Corolla consists of brightly colored structures, are said to be petals. So calyx consists of green color units, are said to be sepals. Corolla consists of brightly colored structures, are said to be petals. So that this calyx and corolla together is said to be non-essential whorls, because it does not take part in actual sexual reproduction. Therefore, it is said to be non-essential whorls. Now coming to the next is andrecium. It is the third whorl of a flower, consists of stamens. These are the male reproductive structures. So stamens are the male reproductive units. Coming to the last is gynecium, also known as pistil. It is an innermost whorl of a flower, which consists of a female reproductive structures, are said to be carpels. So these are the female reproductive structures. So calyx, corolla, andrecium, gynecium. Calyx consists of sepals, corolla consists of petals, andrecium consists of male reproductive structures, are said to be stamens. Gynecium consists of female reproductive structures, are said to be carpels. Now these 2 whorls are said to be non-essential, and the remaining 2, andrecium and gynecium, together is said to be essential whorls, because these 2 take part in sexual reproduction. So this is about the flower consists of 4 whorls: calyx, corolla, andrecium and gynecium. Now, so this is the innermost whorl, and this innermost whorl is nothing but, it is the gynecium, which consists of carpels. Here this is the carpel, and then, and these are the male reproductive structures, are said to be stamens. And then brightly colored structures are said to be petals. and then very small structures, green structures that is said to be what do you call sepal. So this is the sepal and this is petal. These are the stamens and this is said to be carpel. So flower, it is a reproductive part of the plant body and it consists of a stalk that is said to be pedicel. Tip of the pedicel is said to be thalamus and flower consists of four whorls. First is the calyx, it is an outermost whorl, consists of green colored units are said to be sepals. And coming to the second whorl is corolla, which consists of brightly colored structures are said to be petals. And these two are said to be non-essential whorls. And then the third whorl is said to be andrecium, which consists of a male reproductive structures are said to be stamens. And innermost whorl is said to be gynoecium, also known as pistil. And it contains a female reproductive structure that is said to be carpel. So now we are going to study andrecium and gynoecium in detail because these two that helps in sexual reproduction. Next is andrecium. It is the third whorl of a flower, consists of male reproductive units are said to be stamens. Now coming to the parts of a stamen. Stamen consists of three parts. The terminal knob-like structure and then the elongated stalk-like structure. So this elongated stalk-like structure is said to be filament and the terminal knob-like structures are said to be anthers. The function of these anthers is to produce pollen grains. Now, between the anthers and the filament, there is a presence of tissue that connects these two and this tissue is said to be connective. So, totally, stamen consists of three parts. Elongated stalk is said to be filament. And the terminal elongated or a knob-like structures are said to be anthers. Function of the anthers is to produce pollen grains. And between the anther and a filament, there is a presence of a tissue. That tissue is said to be connective tissue. Now, if there is a presence of two anther lobes like this, then it is said to be dithecous anther. As the name itself indicates, di refers to two, thecous refers to lobes. So there is a presence of two anther lobes, then it is said to be dithecous, present in almost all the flowers. And in some cases what happens, there is a presence of like this, only one anther lobe. This is said to be monothecous. It is seen in hibiscus. So presence of two anther lobes, presence of one anther lobe. So this is about the parts of a stamen. Next, we'll move on to transverse section of dithecous anther. Transverse section of dithecous anther. TS of dithecous anther. or microsporangium. As we studied, this is the filament, and here there is a presence of two anther lobes. So, when we take transverse section like this and observe under the microscope, when we take the transverse section of the dithegus anther, you can see there is a presence of like this four chambers. Or microsporangia. Here there is a presence of connective tissue so that it helps in connection between the anthers and filament. I will write only this part here so that each chamber is surrounded by four layers. This is an outermost layer and this is said to be a single layer and this layer is said to be epidermis. And inner to the epidermis, there is a presence of one more single layer and this layer is said to be endothecium. And inner to the endothecium, there is a presence of multi-layered and this layer is said to be middle layer. So, this is the middle layer. Outermost is the epidermis, inner to the epidermis, endothecium. Inner to the endothecium, there is a presence of multi-layered region that is said to be middle layer. These three layers that mainly gives protection and also it helps in dehiscence of the pollen grains from the anther. And then coming to the next, innermost layer is said to be this part. Innermost layer is said to be a nutritive layer and this layer is said to be tapetum. So totally, when we take the transverse section of the dithegus anther, there is a presence of four chambers or microsporangia. Each microsporangium that is covered by four layers. Outermost is the epidermis. Inner to the epidermis, there is a presence of endothecium. And inner to the endothecium, there is a presence of multi-layered region that is said to be middle layer. And then these three mainly gives protection and also it helps in dehiscence of the pollen grains from the anther. And innermost region is or the layer is said to be tapetum so that it contains more than one nuclei and the cytoplasm is dense so that this layer is said to be nutritive layer. So this tapetum gives nutrition for the development of pollen grains. Inside the each chamber or microsporangium, there is a presence of similar cells. Therefore, it is said to be homogeneous cells. And these cells are said to be sporogenous tissue. And here, the sporogenous tissue which undergoes division, there will be a formation of pollen grains and these pollen grains which comes out of the anther through the opening here and this opening is said to be stomium. This is about the transverse section of diathecous anther. As the name itself indicates, diathecous, presence of two anther lobes. When we take the transverse section of the diathecous anther, you can see there is a presence of four chambers or microsporangia, and each one is said to be microsporangium, and each microsporangium is surrounded by four layers: epidermis, endothecium, middle layer. These three gives protection and also helps in dehiscence of the pollen grains, and the innermost layer is said to be tapetum, which contains more than one nuclei, and the cytoplasm is dense and it gives or it provides nutrition for the development of pollen grains. And then inside the each chamber, microsporangia, there is a presence of homogeneous tissue. This homogeneous tissue is said to be sporogenous tissue. And here each sporogenous tissue now act as a pollen mother cell, which undergoes division. There will be a formation of number of pollen grains, and these pollen grains are dehisced through this opening. This is said to be stomium. So this is about the transverse section of diathecous anther. Next, we'll move on to microsporogenesis. Next is microsporogenesis. It is the synthesis of microspore from microspore mother cell or pollen mother cell. That is said to be microsporogenesis. We already studied inside the microsporangia, there is a presence of homogeneous tissue. So in the homogeneous tissue, what happens? Each cell now act as a pollen mother cell. This is said to be pollen mother cell, also known as microspore mother cell. And this pollen mother cell, which undergoes meiosis, there will be a formation of four cells like this, and these are said to be microspores. And there will be a formation of four cells, therefore it is said to be microspore tetrad. Each one is said to be microspore. Each one is said to be microspore. So this process is said to be microsporogenesis. Synthesis of microspore from the pollen mother cell, also known as microspore mother cell. So inside the microsporangia, there is a presence of number of cells or the tissues that is said to be sporogenous tissue. Each cell in the sporogenous tissue now act as a pollen mother cell, which undergoes meiosis, results in the formation of microspore tetrad, and each microspore now finally, this microspore finally undergoes mitotic or mitosis. There will be a formation of pollen grain like this. So this is the pollen grain. So first is the formation of microspore from pollen mother cell, which undergoes meiosis, results in the formation of microspore tetrad, and each one is said to be microspore. Microspore now undergoes mitotic division. There will be a formation of two unequal cells like this. The smaller one and the larger one. The smaller one is said to be generative cell. Larger one is said to be vegetative cell. So this microspore undergoes mitotic division. There will be a formation of unequal cells. The smaller one is the generative cell. The larger one is the vegetative cell. Finally organizes into pollen grain. Now coming to the structure of pollen grain. Pollen grain, it is a microscopic. It is a microscopic oval or a spherical in shape, and it is the diameter measure about 20 to 50 micrometer, and then here it is bounded by wall which is differentiated into two layers. This is said to be outer exine and the inner is said to be intine. So the wall is differentiated into two layers, outer very hard, spiny, non-elastic in nature. That is said to be exine, and this exine is made up of a substance that is said to be sporopollenin. Due to the presence of sporopollenin, it is highly resistant to some of the acids, alkalis or any other chemical. So microsporogenesis means synthesis of microspore from pollen mother cell. This microspore undergoes mitotic division. There will be a formation of, or it get organizes into pollen grain, and each pollen grain is a microscopic oval or a spherical in shape, and it is bounded by a layer which is differentiated into outer very hard spiny exine which is made up of sporopollenin, and inner very smooth layer that is made up of cellulose that is said to be intine. And then there is a presence of two types of cells. The smaller one is the generative cell and the larger one is said to be vegetative cell. So here there is an absence of, this part is said to be intine. In some places there is an absence of sporopollenin. Sporopollenin is completely absent and this part is said to be germ pore. So that this germ pore that mainly helps in germination. So that when the pollen grain falls on the stigmatic surface, what happens? This part, that is nothing but the germ pore, that elongates. There will be a growth of the pollen tube like this. So this is about the structure of pollen grain. In angiosperms, pollen grain is shed at two cell stages. One is said to be generative, second one is a vegetative. But in other species, here what happens, this generative cell divides into two, that results in the formation of two male gametes. So that in other species, the pollen grain shed at three cell stages. In hibiscus, yellowish powdery pollen grains that develop at the tip of the stamens, and these pollen grains sprinkled on a glass slide which contains water, and you can observe under the microscope. Next, coming to the viability of the pollen grains, in some cereals the pollen grains lose their viability within 30 minutes. In some of the examples like rosaceae, leguminosae, solanaceae, the viability that maintains up to 1 month, and these pollen grains can be stored by using liquid nitrogen. Pollen grains of many species that causes severe allergy and bronchial infection like asthma and respiratory tract infection, best example is Parthenium. Pollen grains are very rich in food supplements. In Western countries, these pollen products are used in the form of either syrup or in the form of tablet, and generally used by athletes. So this is about the andrecium. So andrecium, it is the third whole of a flower, consists of male reproductive structures are said to be stamens. Each stamen consists of three parts. Elongated part is the stalk. Terminal knob-like structures are said to be anthers. Between the anthers and the filament, there is a presence of a tissue that is said to be connective tissue. So, if there is a presence of two anther lobes, then it is said to be dithecous. Presence of one anther lobe, then it is said to be monothecous. And then when we take the transverse section of the dithecous anther and observe under the microscope, we can see there is a presence of four chambers or microsporangia, and each microsporangium that is surrounded by four layers: epidermis, endothecium, middle layer. These three gives protection and also helps in dehiscence of the pollen grain. And then the innermost layer is said to be nutritive layer. That layer is said to be tapetum, so that it provides nutrition for the development of pollen grain. And inside the microsporangium, there is a presence of sporogenous tissue, and each cell now acts as a pollen mother cell, which undergoes meiosis division that results in the formation of microspore tetrad, and each one is said to be microspore. Microspore now undergoes mitotic division that results in the formation of pollen grain. So pollen grain, it is nothing but it is a microscopic units are synthesized inside the microsporangia. And here each microspore is oval or spherical in shape, and it is bounded by two layers. Outer exine is very hard, spiny in nature due to the presence of sporopollenin, and some places it is absent. That region is said to be germ pore. And then inner intine is a very smooth layer, and it is made up of cellulose. And then there is a presence of two types of cells. One is said to be generative, second one is said to be vegetative cell. Generally, in all angiosperm, the pollen grain shed at two cell stages. In other species, it is shed at three cell stages. Pollen grain of many species that causes severe allergy and bronchial infection. And then some of the pollen grains are used as a food supplement because it contains very rich in nutrition. So this is about the andrecium. I hope you understood this session. Thank you.